মেশিনটা অন হচ্ছে। ওকে, সো ইটস রেকর্ডিং নাও, আমি এবার স্টার্ট করছি। ফুল স্ক্রিন মোড। Good evening. So today we are into a new series of lectures in this corona times and lockdown times. So in this zoology web lecture series, lecture one, myself, Dr. Malavika Bhattacharya, head postgraduate department of zoology, welcome you all, welcome all the participants, speakers, scholars and faculties. And today we have amidst us as a resource person, Ritam Chatterjee. He's a postdoctoral fellow in IIT Kharagpur. So I'll just give a very brief introduction about Ritam. Ritam completed his post-graduation from CU in 2011 and qualified NET as well as GET in 2012. And then joined the Department of Biochemistry and Medical Biotechnology under the guidance of Dr. Sujata Law, where he worked on bone marrow aplasia and stem stromal microenvironmental scenario regarding pathophysiology and kinase phosphatase balance. During his 6-year PhD tenure, he has published his work in 13 scientific international journal of repute. And I was quite mesmerized by his list of publications, and notable among which are his papers in the European Journal of Cell Biology, Chemico-Biological Interactions, Molecular and Cellular Biochemistry, Leukemia Research, Experimental Cell Research, Experimental Toxicology, Experimental Oncology. He has already been invited to speak at seven invited lectures to his credit. And he has presented his work in this brief span. If he has joined lab, you can assume in 2012, and now it's 2018. So within this 6-year span, he has presented his work in 21 national and international conferences. So that is quite a credit. Currently, he is working in the capacity of DBT Research Associate at the School of Medical Science and Technology, Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur, under the able guidance of Professor Jyotirmoy Chatterjee. From July 2018. His present area of work is elucidating malignant potentiality of oral pre-malignant disorders using molecular pathology and mechanobiological attributes. So that's a great job, Ritam, you have done. And going through your publication list yesterday, in fact, I was wondering that, yes, you have reached quite some height within this 6 years. And with this, I would request Ritam to please, then I welcome you again, and you can now present your lecture. You can now share your lecture.
Yeah, and from where I have to share it, please guide me.
See, when you open the Google Meet,
yeah,
there is a, at the bottom there is a three, there is a bar, and you can let me first stop presenting. Okay. I've stopped presenting.
Yeah.
And there is a bar, and there it is written present now.
Yeah.
When you click that present now, if you open that, the window comes and there are three options. You choose the option present a window.
Yeah.
So if your presentation is already there, that will show. Click on that window and that will show.
Yeah.
Please, students, don't present. Please, it's a request. Don't.
Yeah.
Don't press the present button. See, Ritam, when you present now, you see there is an option coming, a window.
Yeah, I can see it. Present now.
When you see the window, you will be able to see all the windows open in your computer when you press that window.
But I can see the, I can see this screen only. So what I have to do is
No, you cannot see, when you are present, pushing that option.
Now I can. Now I understood.
Yes, yes. Click that window and share.
Yeah. You can see. Can it be visible to you?
Yes. You are presenting. It's showing you are presenting. Yes. We can see it. Fine. It's great.
Okay. Thank you. So, may I start?
Yes, you can start.
First of all, I am very, very thankful to Malavika Di for giving me this opportunity to speak at the Vivekananda College. And actually, the name of your college is giving me goosebumps, because I am a... Actually, Swami Vivekananda is my friend. I consider him as my friend. And is it fair? The screen is fumbling or something is happening?
No, right now the screen is fine.
Yeah. Okay. So, actually, I am fan of Swami Vivekananda, and I consider him as my friend, and at every hardship that I faced, I take his refuge, and he is a support to me. And today, in this pandemic condition, where the entire world is in grief, so let me start by Indianizing the concept of webinar. Let me start with a prayer to Swamiji, and thereafter I will continue. Om Namah Sri Jyotirajaya Vivekananda Suraye Satchit Sukha Sharupaya Swamine Tapaharine Asato Ma Sadgamaya Tamaso Ma Jyotirgamaya Mrityurma Amritam Gamaya Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. As Malavika Di told me that today the main target audience are students. Actually, students are future days Jesse Bose. Students are future days Acharya Prafulla Chandra Ray, future APJ Abdul Kalam, future Madame Curie, future Barbara McClintock, future Rosalind Franklin, and all. So I welcome you, students. And this is, today is not a forum to show how great speaker I am, but I consider this presentation as a motivational presentation so that I can motivate you for pursuing science, for appreciating the art in science. So let me start my presentation. Myself, Ritam, working as postdoctoral fellow at School of Medical Science and Technology, IIT Kharagpur. And today I am going to talk on oxidative stress in the perspective of hematopathology and oncology. So, reactive oxygen species are certain oxygen species having lone pair of electrons at their outermost shell, which makes them highly reactive. ROS can be produced either due to oxygen leakage during aerobic respiration or due to NOx-mediated oxidation of NADPH. Why the full screen is not coming, I don't know. But when ROS modifies the cellular macromolecules, and it is affecting the DNA or the nucleic acid, it leads to oxidative stress. And oxidative stress can be linked with various disorders, cancer being one of them. There are other many disorders too. And you, if you go through this review article of mine, ROS and Oncogenesis with Special Reference to EMT and Stemness, it has been published recently and it is getting many, many citations. You can have an immense idea about ROS. So, today my presentation, I have divided it into two parts. Firstly, I will talk regarding the oxidative stress and hematopoietic alterations that I have worked at during my PhD. And secondly, I will talk about oxidative stress and oncology. So let's begin. So what is hematopoiesis? Let us appreciate the art in science. Here, hematopoiesis is a step-by-step process of the synthesis of various blood cells from the basic stem cell population. Now, it can be regarded as a process, as a three-way process. See, the synthesis of mature blood cell, it can be regarded as srishti. After the formation of the blood cells, it can be regarded as a sthiti. And these blood cells will ultimately die and will be replaced by new ones. So that dying of the blood cells is called sanghara. So the balance between srishti, sthiti and sanghara is what we call homeostasis. Now, the hematopoietic homeostasis during in prenatal condition used to take place at York sac, at placenta, at aorta gonad mesonephros region, at fetal liver. But after birth, the entire process got shifted to bone marrow. So bone marrow acts as the major postnatal reservoir for hematopoiesis, and any catastrophe in this domain can lead to various pathophysiological conditions. Now, physiology is the normal system and the pathophysiology is the abnormal system or the changed condition. So this catastrophe, as I have told, that various catastrophe may lead to this. That catastrophe can be compared with the phenomena of pralaya. So this here is a simile. So this is, if we consider a normal beautiful garden as normal hematopoietic physiology, during various pathophysiological condition, different things happens. In aplastic condition, the total devastation of hematopoiesis occurs. During MDS or myelodysplastic syndrome, what happens? The cells multiply, but they go dying. And this is leukemia, where at the cost of normal cells, the abnormal cells are growing. I have, during my PhD, I have worked in all the three domains, but my major PhD thesis topic is aplastic anemia. So my major thrust will be on aplastic anemia. And I will also present in one slide regarding MDS as well as leukemia. So let's have a look what aplastic anemia is. Aplastic anemia is a special type of anemia which occurs due to bone marrow failure. If any problem occurs in the hematopoietic cells, so the synthesis of different blood cell lineages are hampered, and the generating resulting anemia is called aplastic anemia. In 1888, Paul Ehrlich first coined the term, and the disease involves two things. One is pancytopenia in peripheral blood. Pancytopenia means decline of all the blood cells. And another is hypocellular marrow, or the bone, as the bone marrow acts as the major reservoir for hematopoiesis, so the marrow becomes hypocellular. The signs and symptoms of aplastic anemia involves development of anemic condition, bleeding, ecchymosis is the bleeding due to the rupture of blood vessels, bleeding from gums, bleeding from nose. Actually, epistaxis is the bleeding from nose. Various types of infections, mouth ulcers, fever, etc. are associated with aplastic anemia. Aplastic anemia can be diagnosed by two processes. Firstly, by studying the peripheral blood hemogram, where we can find pancytopenia. Along with which, if we study the bone marrow, we can found the hypocellular nature of the marrow as well as increased fat cells. The etiological factors may be various for aplastic anemia. It can be acquired or inherited. The majority are idiopathic. Idiopathic means why it is caused, it is not known. And various drugs such as busulfan, cyclophosphamide, actually these are antineoplastic drugs. These are used to treat cancers. But if cancer gets cured, it can secondarily affect the bone marrow to lead to aplastic condition. Exposure to various chemicals such as benzene, radiation exposure, viral illness, etc. can result in the development of acquired aplastic anemia. And the inherited one is known as Fanconi's anemia. In our lab at Calcutta School of Tropical Medicine, we have developed the model of aplastic anemia using busulfan and cyclophosphamide. At certain doses, we have injected to each drug, we have injected twice at an interval of 28 days, and the disease developed 3 months after the second dosing. So it actually recapitulates the long-term bone marrow failure condition, and we have followed the protocol of Handin et al. Then we characterized the disease firstly by peripheral blood hemogram, and we have found that whether it be WBC, whether it be RBC, platelets, hemoglobin, retic, all decreased, and the decline of neutrophils shows the myelosuppressive nature of the disease. And what happens in the bone marrow is that the normal cellular composition of bone marrow is replaced by fat cells in aplastic condition. The bone marrow smear study also depicted the same thing. And when we flushed out the femoral marrow and counted them, and we have found a decreased cellularity. In short-term culture, this is cell release kinetics. We have studied the cell release pattern from bone marrow explant at an interval of 24 hours. And you can see that as compared to the control in aplasia, the condition is totally devastated. So what is the scenario at the stem progenitor zone? This is done by the process of flow cytometry, FACS. I think the MSc students know what is FACS, what is flow cytometry, but for student of BSc, it is a technique which used the basic principle of ELISA. You have read, I think you have read about ELISA, that is primary antibody, which again gets tagged by the secondary antibody. Secondary antibody is tagged with the fluorescent and it gives the fluorescence, and from that fluorescent information, we can interpret what is happening. And this flow cytometry is a machine that used cell by cell to give generate the data. So this Ka and Sikitar actually are markers. Say for example, the sadhus of Belur Mot, they used to wear the Gerua dress, and that is their marker. So the hematopoietic stem progenitor population, they also have certain markers. These are proteins. Compared to the control, you can see that in aplastic condition, the stem cells, the hematopoietic stem cells has decreased a lot. The CD150 is also another marker, which also, whose expression also shows that the stem progenitor population has hampered in case of aplastic condition. C-kit is the sole marker of stem cell as well as the progenitor population. Both of the cells have decreased. We separately studied each of the progenitor populations, CFUG, EMM, CFUG, EM, CFUG. CFU means colony forming unit. GEMM is granulocyte, erythrocyte, macrophage marker. GM means granulocyte, macrophage. CFU G means colony forming unit, granulocytes. E means CFU E means colony forming unit, erythrocyte. And BFU E is blast forming unit, erythrocyte. And all the progenitors have declined a lot in aplastic conditions. So what the situation is that busulfan and cyclophosphamide, the drugs which are used to generate aplastic anemic model, is affecting the stem progenitor population, which is leading to marrow hypocellularity, which results in peripheral blood pancytopenia. After which, we have studied the functional efficacy of bone marrow, how it is changing in aplastic condition. We studied the...
Rita, I'm interfering. I'm going to go screen presentation. Tomar screen is on screen. আচ্ছা বাকিরা যদি কেউ দেখতে না পাও দেখবে মানে আই থিংক সো প্রেজেন্টেশনটা দেখতে পাচ্ছ সবাই দেখতে পাচ্ছ কাম একজন কেউ একটু বলো তো
হ্যাঁ ম্যাম হ্যাঁ ম্যাম
দেখতে পাচ্ছি ফাইন 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 না ম্যাম পাচ্ছি যদি না পাও তাহলে দেখবে একটু স্ক্রল ডাউন করো আরেকটাতে একটা প্রেজেন্টেশনের ইমেল ইয়ে আইকন পাবে সেটাতে পিন করে দিলে প্রেজেন্টেশনটা চলে আসবে ওকে স্ক্রল স্ক্রল ডাউন দেখবে একটা প্রেজেন্টেশনের মানে রিতা মেরি আরেকটা account is presenting সেটা পিন করে দাও ওটা চলে আসবে ওকে ওকে রিতাম থ্যাংক ইউ কন্টিনিউ
হ্যাঁ থ্যাংক ইউ ম্যাম সো উই হ্যাভ স্টাডিড দ্য ফাংশনাল এফিকেসি অফ বোন ম্যারো এন্ড দ্য ফ্যাগোসাইটিক এবিলিটি ডিক্রিজড আ লট ইন অ্যাপ্লাস্টিক কন্ডিশন বাট দ্য সাইটোটক্সিক এবিলিটি ডিক্রিজড দ্য ইনেট ইমিউনিটি স্টাডি দিস ইজ আ ভেরি ইন্টারেস্টিং স্টাডি হোয়ার উই হ্যাভ কালেক্টেড দ্য পেরিটোনিয়াল ম্যাক্রোফাজ then seeded it on the glass, simple glass slides, and macrophages are glass adhering molecule, glass adhering cells. And when we incubated this with foreign cells, we have incubated it with sarcoma-1-80 cell lines. How many macrophages are engulfing that cells? We have counted that, and we have found that the innate immunity, the first line of defense, is hampered in case of aplastic anemia. The cellular viability decreased. The MTT assay shows that the cells are very much cytotoxically affected. The neutral red retention assay, this is also a very interesting assay. Neutral red actually stains the lysosome. If there is any leakage in lysosomes, what happens is that the stain comes out of the lysosome and stains the entire cytoplasm. So from in this way, we can count the ratio of leaked and unleaked lysosomes. And this actually denotes the cytotoxic, insult that the cells has affected. And we have done this neutral red retention assay and shown that the aplastic anemic cells are very much affected by the cytotoxic insults. Now, basic to this entire catastrophe, we have identified two phenomena. Firstly, our seniors, and Malavika Dee knows সুমন্তদা প্রতিমাদি তুমি চেনো তো মালবিকা দি
না এই দাঁড়া এক সেকেন্ড তোর প্রেজেন্টেশনটা আই থিংক সো গট রিমুভড ইজ ইওর প্রেজেন্টেশন ভিজিবল
হ্যাঁ আমার আমি তো ভিজিবল আমি আমার কাছে তো দেখতে যাচ্ছে
তাই
তো
দেখা
যাচ্ছে এখন
wait wait
দাঁড়াও দাঁড়াও আমি দেখছি
yes it's coming it's coming it's coming
আসছে এখন
আসছে আসছে তো
yes
ঠিক আছে from the current slide let me তো আমি যেটা বললাম যেটা আমি বললাম মালবিকা দি তুমি প্রতিমাদি সুমন্তদাদের তো চিনতে
প্রতিমাদি বোস ইনস্টিটিউটের
না 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 তোমার ট্রপিক্যাল এই স্যারের কাছে কাজ করতে ডিউরিং ইন্টারফেস দ্য সেল পাসেস থ্রু G0 G1 S and G2M after which they complete their mitosis. So they have shown that the cells are stuck at G0 G1 and not moving through S and G2M phase. What I have done is that through a basic idea regarding BRDO. BRDO is bromodiuridine. It is a thymidine analog. Actually, when during replication, it competes with the thymidine to form the DNA. So what we have done is BRDO assay. We have in the animals we have injected BRDO and have seen how the BRDO the cells are taking the BRDO. The BRDO positive cells, that is the cells are in S phase. BRDO dim cells are the cells in G2M phase, and BRDO negative cells are G0 G1 cells. And we have found that the BRDO positivity decreased a lot in case of aplastic anemia. That is, they are stuck at G0 G1. They are not moving through S and G2M phase. So we have found the case of proliferative hindrance, and secondly, we have found the case of apoptosis. Apoptosis, you know, the BSc first year students, I think they don't know because apoptosis is a programmed cell death. It is a programmed cell death.
ওরা জানে ওরা সেকেন্ড সেমিস্টারে অ্যাপোটোসিস পড়েছে সেল বায়োলজিতে
আচ্ছা ঠিক আছে সো দে হ্যাভ গন থ্রু অ্যাপোপ্টোসিস অ্যাপোপ্টোসিস আমরা কি করে দেখেছি আমরা দেখেছি অ্যাক্রিডিন অরেঞ্জ ইটিবিআর ডুয়েল স্টেনিং দিয়ে এন্ড দ্য সেলস হুইচ হ্যাভ টেকেন দ্য ইটিবিআর দে আর অ্যাপোপ্টোটিক সেলস এন্ড ইন কেস অফ অ্যাপোপ্টোসিস ওয়ান হলমার্ক ইজ মেমব্রেন ব্লেডিং ইউ সি দিস ইজ স্ক্যানিং ইলেকট্রন মাইক্রোস্কোপিক পিকচার এন্ড ইউ ক্যান সি দ্যাট compared to control in aplastic condition, the cells have many membrane blebs. Finally, how we confirmed apoptosis? We have studied the marker expression of caspase-3. Caspase-3 is the ultimate executor of apoptosis, and we have found that it has increased a lot in aplastic condition. Here, I want to draw your attention. See, it is a process which is entirely opposite to that of cancer. In cancer, what happens? The cell proliferates, and they does not go apoptosis. So they are hyperproliferative and anti-apoptotic. And here is the case is, it is hyperproliferative. The cells are not proliferating. And it is hyper-apoptotic. So a lot of works have been done in case of cancer, but this domain, the works are still lacking. I have tried to touch upon this. I raised two questions. See, during my raising question is very, very important in case of biology. As you have read that Nicotinberg and Spohr question in animal behavior, why, how, what, which, these are certain questions. So raising the question and finding the answers is very, very important. And actually those are the basis of the doing certain research. So I raise two questions. Why is cellular proliferation hindered? And why the cells are going through apoptosis? So let's find the answer. Our hypothesis was that since busulfan and cyclophosphamide are DNA alkylating agents, so might there be certain genomic damage which leads to mitotic catastrophe and cellular death? We have validated our hypothesis through, firstly through toluidine blue staining. Actually, toluidine stains very deeply those cells having genomic damage. And we have found that the cells which are affected mostly due to genomic damage has taken more and more toluidine, are more and more toluidine blue positive, and actually the ETBR uptake is also due to DNA damage. And what we have seen, studied the DAPI staining, and we have validated with face contrast, and we have found CVR chromosomal condensation or damage in aplastic condition. Now, how it is corroborated in the disease pathophysiology? So these are certain data. I think if this can be certain boring to you, I am directly going to the result. See what is happening. Busulfan and cyclophosphamide is actually causing the DNA damage, and DNA damage is causing the protein kinase B to be decreased. Now, protein kinase B is an inhibitor to GSK3 beta. Whenever the protein kinase B is decreasing, the GSK3 beta is getting upregulated. And what GSK3 beta is doing is that, firstly, it is activating caspase-3 to cause apoptosis. Secondly, it is causing the cyclin. It is a known inhibitor of cyclin D1. Cyclin D1 is required for the passage of cell from G0, G1 to S phase. So cyclin D1 is also decreasing, and it is decreasing PP2A. And what PP2A is doing, PP2A is actually involved in activating CDC25C. CDC25C is a G2M promoter. And whenever the PP2A is decreasing, the CDC25C activation is also hampered. And we have also seen that the DNA damage is decreasing the polo-like kinase 1, which is also affecting the CDC25C. And it is also affecting the Aurora kinase A. As a result, Aurora kinase A actually helps in the attachment of centromere with the spindle fiber. So M-phase impairment is there, as well as apoptosis is also occurring. So one very interesting thing you can find, you have knowledge regarding cell signaling. There are various types of cell signaling you have read, but you cannot find this type of signaling in any textbook. You can find the bits and pieces, but not the entire thing. When I find all this data, I put this in a format of cell signaling. And Molecular and Cellular Biochemistry, this is one of the pioneer journal in this field, they have accepted this. So this is a cell signaling, which I named it a non-classical DNA damage response pathway that has been revealed by our work. So this is non-classical DNA damage pathway. So what now, let's see what is happening in classical DNA damage pathway. In classical DNA damage pathway, you know, whenever there is DNA damage, the P53, the tumor suppressor, gets upregulated, and it is upregulating the P21. But what we have found is that a twist we have found here. There is a twist. The P53 is not upregulated. It is rather downregulated. But the P21 is upregulated. So actually, I repeated why this is happening. I am going through, then I am going through various literatures, but then it appears to me that P21 can be activated in P53 independent way, and that occurs through the downregulation of c-myc oncogene. We have studied the expression of c-myc, and we have found the c-myc to be downregulated, and that can be linked with the P21. Furthermore, whether the P53 pathway is really inactivated, we have studied the upstream and as well as the hematopoiesis specific downstream molecule of P53. At the upstream of P53, we have found that the ATM and CHK2 are all downregulated, and at the downstream also, NEGDIN and GFI1, these are hematopoiesis specific downstream regulators of P53, they are also downregulated. So it appears that the P53 signaling is totally downregulated, and P21 is affecting its anti-proliferative property through P53 independent pathway through upregulation of c-myc. To further validate it, so through various literatures, it appears that why P53 pathway is downregulated. If it had no role, it wouldn't have changed, but it is downregulated. Then various literatures shows me that P53 pathway is always also required for the repairing of the DNA and re-entry of the cells into the cell cycle. Perhaps this process is irreversible. This genomic damage is irreversible. To validate that, we have studied Ku80. Ku80 is a protein. Whether there is any repairable DNA damage, it is recruited there. But we have found it is to be down-regulated in case of aplastic anemia. So, what appears is that the busulfan and cyclophosphamide affecting the bone marrow, causing DNA damage. DNA damage is maintaining the P21 level, and c-MYC is through the down-regulation of c-MYC, the P21 is maintained. And how this c-MYC is down-regulated, I will come in later section, and you can see that the process of P53 is down-regulated as well as Ku80 is down-regulated, which implies to the impaired DNA damage. As well as the CHK1 serine 317 phosphorylated form is down-regulated, which also indicated to the replicative senescence that the cell is not replicating, the cell is not multiplying. So the non-classical DNA damage pathway is also impaired, and the classical DNA damage pathway is also impaired. Then we have studied various cell cycle inhibitors. GSK3-beta and P21, as I have told earlier, GSK3-beta is cycling D1 inhibitor. P21 is a pan-cycling CDK inhibitor, and the ligand and the protein that binds with the cycling D, one is CDK4, cycling-dependent kinase 4. And the inhibitor of cycling-dependent kinase 4 is P18. So we have found that GSK3-beta to be upregulated, P21 to be upregulated, P18 to be upregulated, and simultaneously the CDK4 is also downregulated. So all the cell cycle inhibitors are upregulated, which contributed to the cellular hypoproliferation. Then the major part, as I have told you, that if I wouldn't have told that part, then it would be an incomplete. How oxidative stress is involved here? DNA damage is also involved with generating various oxidative stress. And we have measured the oxidative stress through dihydroethidium staining. Actually, these stains enters into the live cells, and if there is ROS or reactive oxygen species, they are converted to ethidium bromide, and ethidium bromide gives the red fluorescence. So we have measured the fluorescent intensity, and we have found that in aplastic condition, its intensity is very, very higher as compared to that of control, and so there is increased ROS. Now, how ROS is related to cellular pathophysiology? If you go through various literatures, you can find that the increase of ROS is associated with the deregulation of mitochondrial membrane potential. And we have found through DIOC6 staining that in case of aplastic anemia, there is collapse of mitochondrial membrane potential, and mitochondrial membrane potential is one of the cause for apoptosis. So in this way, we can also link how the ROS is causing cellular apoptosis. Now, for every stem cells, the cells are not able to grow or multiply or differentiate by their own. It requires certain support. And the support system is called the microenvironment or the niche. Please don't misunderstand me, because in case of ecology, you have known what is niche, what is habitat. In that case, niche is the role of an biome or of an bioorganism in the environment, and habitat is their address. But here in cell biology, niche is the microenvironment, or it acts as the habitat. And the hematopoietic stem cells are protected in hypoxic condition. Hypoxic condition means the scarcity of oxygen, by the osteoblast, and it is called osteoblastic niche. What happens is that when there is an increase of ROS, the osteoblastic niche gets affected. Osteoblastic niche remains at the interface between bone and marrow, and we have studied it by Mallory trichrome staining, and we have found that the osteoblastic lining in case of normal, in case of control, is totally missed in case of aplastic anemia. So here the osteoblastic niche is devastated. We then validated this with, again, by marker study through the RUNX positive cells, they decreased. Alkaline phosphatase positive cells, they decreased. The CD45 negative cells actually indicates a great amount of the microenvironmental components. Apart from osteoblastic niche, it also denotes the vascular niche. It also denotes the stromal niche. The stromal fibroblasts are there. They also access the niche. So that entire niche is affected since the CD45 negative population has decreased. We have then studied through long-term culture that the stroma generation, the generation of stromal microenvironment is very much affected in case of aplastic condition. And we have studied the expression pattern of stromal progenitor cells by studying the Stro1 expression pattern, and stromal progenitors also decreased. The stromal derived factor 1, it helps in recovering the cells from oxidative stress. This has decreased. So the oxidative stress is also an irreversible process. And on the other hand, we have found the negative component of the niche, the negative component that negatively regulates hematopoiesis, the fat cells has increased, and we have seen it through oil redo staining. Now, how this microenvironmental dysregulation is corroborated in the cellular catastrophe? Here is an important signaling called Notch signaling. Here what happens is that the ligand for the signaling, the jacked ones, are expressed by the stromal fibroblasts, the stromal cells, and the receptor, the Notch one, is expressed on the hematopoietic cells. Here we can find that the jacked positive cells have decreased. Obviously, since the entire microenvironment has decreased, so jacked positive cells have decreased. What happens is that when JAG interacts with Notch 1, it causes a cleavage. As a result, the Notch intracellular domain gets separated, and it actually activates CMYC. CMYC is very much responsible for cell renewal and survivability of hematopoietic cells. We have found that the clipped Notch 1 is also decreased. The cleaving enzyme, the presenilin 1, they also decreased, and the CMYC is also decreased. So how this CMYC, that CMYC, previously I said that CMYC is related to the TP53 independent activation of P21. This CMYC is thus deregulated here, and it affects the cellular self-renewal as well as the survivability. And through various pathways, Notch also controls the expression pattern of SOD2. SOD2 is an ROS scavenger. It scavenges out the ROS. But the antioxidant SOD2 here is decreased, and it can be linked with the Notch pathway. So it added to the hematopoietic catastrophe. Now, ROS can be linked with various epigenetic alteration too. Epigenetics, I know that some days ago, some of the presenters has presented on epigenetics. So you know what epigenetics is. These are certain environmental factors, non-genetic factors that regulates the expressional biology. So this can be DNA methylation, histone modification, and all that. So we have found is that there is global DNA CpG hypomethylation, which we have tested by staining 5-methyl cytosine, and we have found a global DNA hypomethylation, along with which we have found the methylating enzyme DNMT1, DNA methyl transferase 1, it has also decreased. So there is, at a level of DNA damage, there is ROS associated DNA hypomethylation. And at histone 3, we have found that the phosphohistone 3, phosphorylation of histone 3 at serine 10 has increased a lot in case of aplastic condition. Now, phosphorylation of histone 3 at serine 10 is required for proliferation as well as for apoptosis, because it causes DNA condensation, and DNA condensation is the prior step for both proliferation as well as for apoptosis. But since Aurora kinase A is decreased, in presence of Aurora kinase A, actually the histone 3 phosphorylation is associated with proliferation. But previously I have shown you that the Aurora kinase A is decreased. So here it is not linked with proliferation. Rather, we have found the nuclear condensation, which can be linked with the apoptotic attribution of histone 3 phosphorylation. And PP1, the dephosphorylating enzyme of our histone 3, is also decreased. And here the caspase 3, as I have shown you earlier, the caspase 3 is also increased. So it indicates that the histone 3 phosphorylation is associated with cellular apoptosis. So here it appears that the aplastic stress is inducing the ROS, which is bringing the epigenetic alteration resulting in cellular apoptosis. So I have published this data at European Journal of Cell Biology, and what happens is that during this aplastic conversion from normal hematopoietic physiology, actually aplastic anemic stress is increasing the loss, and its effect is added due to the decrease of SOD2 level, and this loss is actually inhibiting the microenvironmental support to the hematopoietic stem progenitor population. It is the SDF1 decrease also causing the disruption of HSPC. The ROS is causing alterations of epigenetics as well as the NOT signaling. So here is a scenario of total microenvironmental failure, and ROS is also increasing the adipocytes. So total microenvironmental failure that contributes to the cellular catastrophe. So what emerged from my study during PhD is that DNA damage accumulation is altering protein kinase B, GSK3 beta axis, PP2A, polo-like kinase 1, Aurora kinase A, and PP21 to result in the cellular hyperproliferation and apoptosis. It is also changing the redox level of the cells, leading to the drop of cellular energetics, affect the microenvironment, alters the epigenetic condition, which also added to the pathophysiology. And we think that this mechanistic view of our study can contribute for the development of cell-based therapies for the aplastic anemia, the dreadful disease. As I have told you that, though I have aplastic anemia was my primary area, but I have also first authority publication with regard to leukemia in leukemia research. There actually I have shown how the classical as well as the hematopoiesis specific PPP3 molecule, the NECDIN and GFI1, how they are altered. I have also studied myelodysplastic syndrome. It is an intermediate disease between aplasia and leukemia. And here we have studied the attribution of tumor suppressor cascade, vital cell cycle inhibitors, hematopoietic niche, how they are attributing in the development of the disease. And my work, firstly, the mitochondrial instability and proliferative hindrance that got published at Pathology Research and Practice. The epigenetic and microenvironmental alteration got published at European Journal of Cell Biology. The MDS portion published at Chemicobiological Interaction. The kinase phosphatase alteration got published at Molecular and Cellular Biochemistry. At Leukemia Research, I have the publication regarding the classical and hematopoiesis-specific P53 alteration. And at Proceedings of Zoological Society, actually, I compared the three diseases. Apart from this, during my PhD, I have also worked with the ascitic tumor. I have seen the therapeutic efficacy of rutagraviolins in ascitic tumor. I have also studied how the JAK-STAT pathway is altered in case of myelodysplasia. In experimental cell research, I have publication regarding differential growth pattern of tumors along craniocaudal axis. In cranial region, the tumor grows faster than the caudal region. So how it is occurring, I have published that also. The basic work is of my friend Shukalpa Chattopadhyay, but I assisted her in getting this publication. I have also published that environmental toxicology regarding the non-canonical Wnt signaling in pesticide-induced aplastic anemia. I have publication in cytoskeletal alteration field, as well as in experimental oncology. I have published regarding the HSP90, it is a chaperone, is this chaperone inhibition by 17-AHG. After this, now I am going to present you how oxidative stress is actually involved in oxidative stress in cancer biology. You have seen a case which is entirely opposite to that of cancer. Now let us see what the cancer biology has to do with oxidative stress. So this portion I have done at IIT Kharagpur. So here, in case of here, this, you can also find at this review article of mine, actually, with regard to tumor, ROS can act as a double-edged sword. It is a two-way sword. It can, through various pathways, it can promote tumorogenesis. It can also act as a tumor suppressor through other pathways. Now, from various literatures, it appears that in hypoxic condition, hypoxic condition is the decreased condition of molecular oxygen. The molecular oxygen is decreased. The reactive oxygen species there increases, and it causes a phenotypic plasticity. Phenotypic plasticity means the alteration of cellular phenotypes. The cell shape changes. So it is called the epithelial cells. See, these are epithelial cells. They are getting the phenotypes of mesenchymal cells. And if there is such alteration, the cells actually moves from the primary site and goes to the secondary site. You know that tumor metastasis, that where the cell moves from the primary site and forms metastatic knot at the secondary site. So this process is associated with reactive oxygen species, and the marker is the decline of the epithelial markers decreases, such as E-cadherin decreases in case of mesenchymal cells, as well as the bhementin, the mesenchymal marker, increases. For more than two decades, the epithelio-mesenchymal transition, what I call EMT, is found to be associated with cellular metastasis. But nowadays, it is found that it is also involved in generating certain population within the bulk tumor. And those population are called cancer stem cells. If somebody finds the medicine to cure the cancer stem cells, then we have answer for the cancer. The cancer cells can be killed by various chemotherapeutic drugs, as well as the proliferation can be stopped. But these cancer stem cells, what they does is that they have a huge amount of ABC transporters. They does not allow chemotherapy to enter to them, as well as they have a tremendous superior DNA repairing system. So they cannot be affected by radiation too. And they are actually quiescent cells. Suppose we exert certain therapies, all the cancer cell dies, but these cells remains. They again proliferate and differentiate to form the relapsing of the tumor. And interestingly, this epithelio-mesenchymal transition is initiated by ROS level, but after the formation of cancer stem cells, the ROS level decreases. The decrease of ROS level is actually helping these cancer stem cells to sustain. And how this is happening, which is triggering this, this is not known yet. In our lab, we are working with precancers of oral epithelia, and these are called, and basically I'm working with Oral submucous fibrosis is a failed unhealing disease of buccal mucosa. It is associated with chewing of ericanut alone or together with other tobacco products. It is a failed unhealing condition of buccal mucosa, as I have said you earlier, and it has a high chance of conversion into oral cancer, which we call oral squamous cell carcinoma. And OSF is very common in developing countries, India being one of them. And here my study objective is to explore the association of oxidative stress and EMT with the pathogenesis of both OSF as well as OSCC. Guru Nanak Institute of Dental Science and Research are providing us with the samples of oral tissue, and we have histologically compared them. See, this is the structure of buccal epithelium and subepithelium. The buccal epithelium, see, the cells are stepwise forming the final keratinocytes, and these are rete ridges. These bulging are called rete ridges. This is the epithelial region, and this is the subepithelial region. During OSF, what happens, this flattening of rete ridges occurs. The cell becomes hyperchromatic, and in the subepithelial region, the matrix condensation occurs. In case of oral squamous cell carcinoma, as I have told you earlier, that it is a case of metastasis. The cells from the primary site metastasize to form the secondary knot. The scanning electron microscopy revealed us that the normal distribution of ridges and pits in the supraepithelial regions is converted into pitted condition in OSF, and in case of OSCC, since the cellular metastasis has occurred, the total structural disruption can be found. Then we have studied how oxidative stress is involved here. In cell, I have shown you that we have measured ROS through dihydroetidium staining. But it is impossible to measure ROS in fixed tissue or paraffinized tissue, because ROS has a very small half-life. So here what I have done is, to see how the oxidative stress is present here, we have studied lipid peroxidation. This is an effect of ROS. And I have done this through hydroxynonenone staining, 4-HNE staining. And we have found that compared to normal in case of OSF and OSCC, severe oxidative stress is present. And here the hypoxic condition is also present, since hypoxia inducing factor HIF-1 alpha is also increasing. Now let me say one thing. Previously I have shown you the results of FACS. That is also based on the principle of ELISA, and this is immunohistochemistry. This is also based on the principle of ELISA. Actually this color, these brown colors are due to the HRP or what, horseradish peroxidase. Now you can understand this. So along with the increased oxidative stress, here the hypoxic condition is also prevailing. And now very interesting, I have told you that ROS can act as a tumor promoter as well as tumor suppressor, and the tumor suppressing condition you have seen in aplastic condition. But how it is promoting tumor? Here sarbavin is a molecule that plays very essential role. Sarbavin actually, ROS causes cellular death is a tumor suppressive phenomena. Sarbavin simply goes and inhibits the caspase so that the cell does not die. So the tumor suppressing process is negated and the tumor cell starts converting into malignancy. So and here we have found the expression pattern of sarbavin to be increased from normal to OSF to OSCC. Here also the mitochondrial membrane potential is severely affected. This I have seen through Janus Green B staining. So what appears is that in hypoxic condition, the oxidative stress here due to decline of sarbavin is promoting the malignant progression and inhibiting the apoptosis. Now how this oxidative stress can be linked with EMT? We have found that the link band between EMT and oxidative stress, the phospho-ERK, to be upregulated in OSF and OSCC. And the marker pattern of EMT is also present here. You can see that the expression of E-cadherin is decreasing from normal. The expression of E-cadherin is the epithelial marker. Its expression decreases from normal to OSF to OSCC. And the expression pattern of vimentin, the mesenchymal marker, is increasing from normal to OSF to OSCC. And beta-cadherin is also a marker for EMT, and its expression is also increasing from normal to OSF to OSCC. So here is oxidative stress mediating through ERK activation the EMT progression. Now how can it be linked with the disease pathophysiology? Here I have done Mallory trichrome staining. Now EMT can be of three types. Type 1 EMT is associated with developmental biology, particularly during gas turbulation, during delamination process. During type 2 EMT is associated with development of fibrosis. And type 3 EMT is associated with cellular metastasis. In case of OSF, we have found that in subepithelial region, huge deposition of collagen fiber. So this is a case of fibrotic attribution of EMT. And we have validated this with atomic force microscopy. Here the collagen fibers can be distinctly visible in case of OSF. So the collagen fibers here is causing the fibrosis. So it is a type 2 EMT. And in case of OSCC, we have seen a matrix degradation. The atomic force microscopy also shows the similar thing. So perhaps this is due to making the pathway for cells to migrate from the primary site. And yes, the hematoxylin eosin staining shows that the cells do migrate from the primary site to form the metastatic node. So fibrosis in case of OSF is associated with oxidative stress associated EMT, and in case of OSCC, it is associated with epithelial cell migration. In case of cancer, we have studied the expression pattern of cancer stem cell marker. And particularly in the metastatic node, we have found there is an increased expression of ALDH1. It is a stem cell marker. So here, the EMT is also associated with the generation of stemness or acquisition of stemness. And very recently I have acquired certain data. This is the data regarding Sonic Hedgehog Gli-1 signaling. This is a particular signaling. This actually promotes the sustenance of stemness, and this is activated by hypoxia. And we have found that compared to normal in OSF and OSCC, the Sonic Hedgehog expression increases, as well as the Gli-1, the another part of the expression of another molecule, which is also increasing, particularly in the metastatic node. So the hypoxia associated alteration of sonic hedgehog glee1 signaling is contributing in the maintenance of this stimulus. So it appears is that the oxidative stress related EMT in case of OSF is mediating the subepithelial fibrosis, and in case of OSCC it is mediating the epithelial migration as well as acquisition of stimulus. So in future I have certain plans to discover what is happening in the mechanobiological aspect and also the how the differential level of oxidative stress. I also want to study that, how the oxidative stress, the ROS level is decreasing from the normal cancer cells to cancer stem cells. I do acknowledge the principal and HOD of the Department of Zoology, Vivekananda College. I do acknowledge my PhD guide, Dr. Sujata Law, as well as Professor Jyotirmoy Chatterjee of SMST IIT Kharagpur. I am very much thankful to my lab mates. I am thankful to Guru Nanak Institute of Dental Science and Research for providing me samples for doing the experiment. I am thankful to my parents, sister, grandmother, friends, colleagues, and all well-wishers. And I am, of course, thankful to the Almighty Thakur Ma Shamiji for giving me the strength to execute my work. I am thankful to DBT Research Associate Fellowship Program for funding my research, as well as to West Bengal DBT. They have funded my research during my PhD. Now, see, webinar is a replacement of seminar. In seminar, what happens with every meeting there is eating, but I cannot provide you food. But at the end of every seminar, there used to be certain cultural programs. So, but I can, through 2 to 3 slides, I can give you a glimpse of such a beautiful refreshment. So let us find that. And I think it will take through a down the memory lane of nostalgia, because this is the pictures of mine, but this phase you are passing through, and many of the faculties have passed through this phase and they can relate to this. So these are the institutes where I have worked, really Shomilani Mahavidyalaya, from where I have did my graduation. This is Baliganj Science College, from where I did my master's. This is Calcutta School of Tropical Medicine, from where I did my PhD. And this is IIT Kharagpur, my current workplace. So let us have a trip down the memory lane. So this is a picture in front of my college. This is a picture at Baliganj Science College during what reunion. And seeing how a vibrant group we had. Before puja, all of us used to actually imitate different gods. See, this is Durga. This is Asur. Asur is actually protecting itself with this bottle. This is Saraswati, this is Kartik, and also there are Bahanas. You can see Lakshmi, this is Ganesh, also the Kalabhu is present here. So this is a fun. And these are the pictures. See, this is a group at Calcutta School of Tropical Medicine, the group of our biochemistry and medical biotechnology department. This is how this is my prior to submitting thesis. I have gone to my guide for taking her blessings. And this is my sir at IIT Kharagpur, Professor Jyotirmoy Chatterjee. What happens is at IIT Kharagpur is that every year there used to be holidays. And at holidays, we used to invite all our friends and colleagues. And this is another picture of my holidays. These are my colleagues and this is my sir. So Holi is a festival of color. For 3 pictures I have given, this is from Calcutta University, the Pehchan Kaun picture. And this is at School of Tropical Medicine, and Holi, of course, is special at IIT Kharagpur. This is the Scholars Avenue, where all of us, we used to sit here and enjoy. Actually, Arvind Kejriwal, who also keeps on uploading the picture of IIT Kharagpur during his time. Lockdown is not bad. Actually, it gives me, you can find the good in any situation. It has given me a scope for yoga and meditation, for of exercise, which transformed this hippopotamus to a semi zebra. So I dedicate my whole work to Swamiji. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Hari Om Tat Sat Sri Ram Krishna Arpanamastu. These flowers are actually facing the lights and dependent on light for their blooming. So you all juniors, take the light of science for your blooming. See, andhokare ruchho hote utsharito alo. The light that comes out of the source of darkness. Science is the light that comes out of the source of darkness. সকল দ্বন্দ্ব বিরোধ মাঝে জাগ্রত যে ভালো ইয়েস অফ কোর্স টু পাবলিশ আ পেপার ইউ হ্যাভ টু গো থ্রু আ প্রসেস অফ রিভিউইং অ্যানসারিং দ্য রিভিউয়ার্স অ্যান্ড সেই তো তোমার ভালো অ্যান্ড আলটিমেট দ্যাট সাইন্স দোজ গুডস টু আদার্স সো উইথ দ্য পিকচার অফ ইউর কলেজ আই থ্যাংক ইউ অল থ্যাংক ইউ থ্যাংক ইউ
Pritam.
Haan.
Achha, I'm audible, I think so.
Haan, tumra dekhte pele presentation ta puro?
Puro dekhechi, na dekhar ki ache.
Achha, achha, thik ache.
Achha, what I was saying is that there are two questions from the audience.
Yeah.
So, I have asked one of my students to take up the two questions. Gargi, are you there?
Yes, ma'am, I'm there.
Yeah, so you please take up those two questions in the chat box. So, two questions, Achirito.
वेरी गुड इवनिंग सर आई विल टेक द फर्स्ट क्वेश्चन इट फ्रॉम रंजित शॉ ही हैज आस्क्ड टू क्वेश्चन फर्स्ट वन इज व्हाट ट्रिगर्स द अपरेगुलेशन ऑफ एबीसी ट्रांसपोर्टर्स इन द ट्यूमर सेल्स And if this upregulation, whether it is due to the formation of ROS or is there any other reason?
Yeah, very, very good question. Actually, I have told you that this differential, the ROS level changes from the cancer cells to cancer stem cells. Does here ABC transporters, expression pattern of ABC transporter is playing any role or not? That is a very, very important domain. Here CD44. Volcker molecule. The CD44 is a molecule here. Does it play any role here or not? This I have to see. And this is a very, 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 very good and interesting question. Actually, you please go through the papers and if you find the answers, tell me. I will work in that field. Okay. And second question.
Okay, sir. The second question is being asked by Shonak Shahu. He has asked. How do you differentiate apoptosis and cell division using histone 3 phosphorylation?
Yeah.
And
yeah,
he has got, okay, and there is another question that is, why didn't you use caspase 3 or tunnel acid to understand the apoptosis?
Firstly, I want to answer his second part. I have used the expression pattern of caspase 3. And I have shown you the data that caspase 3 is the ultimate executor of apoptosis and expression pattern studying the expression of caspase 3 is most vital thing to say what apoptosis is going on or not. I have shown it in two slides. One is one at during the slide where first I introduced the concept of apoptosis and another slide during histone 3 phosphorylation. And now I come to the histone 3 phosphorylation pattern. Yes, Sonok, this is a very, very good question. But what you have asked, histone 3 phosphorylation is involved, as I have told, that it is involved in both mitosis as well as in apoptosis. But remember, I have told another thing also. In mitosis, it is associated with the upregulation of Aurora kinase. But here, the Aurora kinase is decreased. So the cellular proliferation attribution of histone 3 can be negated here. And you can, I have also shown you the expression pattern of TP1. TP1 is associated with irreversible DNA phosphorylation, which is mostly associated with apoptosis. So this way I differentiated the histone 3 phosphorylation from apoptosis and cell cycle from cellular proliferation.
8, 8, 5, 7, 8, 3.
Okay, sir. These were the two questions till now, and Shonak is thanking you for answering the question.
Thank you, Shonak. I can see your chat here. Yeah.
Ma'am, is there any other question from anybody else? Because these were the only two ones that came in the chat box.
Can anyone directly interact with Ritam? If anyone thinking of interacting or any questions with Ritam? Okay, Ritam, we are running a bit short of time because we have this one in recording.
So, okay,
thank you so much. Wonderful work and the volume of work you have done. I was going, I was seeing things and I was remembering my lab days when I see it sort of pictures and the assays you were talking about. I was simply remembering my lab days. So now request with much ado, I request our faculty, Dr. Trijit Nondo, to give you thank you votes. Trijita, please.
Okay. Thank you, Malavika Madam. And now, as a general protocol, we have to give you the vote of thanks. The Department of Zoology, Vivekananda College, Thakurpukur, is indebted to Ritam Chatterjee for his so much popular lecture and elucidating the different viable modes of information in a different way. We are also thankful to all the participants and also the fellow mates of Ritam Chatterjee, those who came, incidentally friend of our head of the department, and all the participants here, and elderly participants also, what I can see from here. And to them, my great thanks. And also the students, from the tender stage till the highest level, all of them are so much attentive to learn many new vistas, new lessons of lesson, and lessons of knowledge. And finally, the meeting really ends without eating what Ritam told. We are very sorry because this is a virtual meeting, but in the end, we enjoy it. And the eating is there, you see, and you told about some restrictions also. So, well, when we will meet again, we will have a very conducive time, and you are welcome to our department at any time. And all the, especially the technical situation, technical facets that work so beautifully for this tenure of time, we are also thankful to them and thankful to the God and Vivekananda, as our Ritam said. With this, I like to end. Thank you, everybody.
Thank you once more.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thanks to all.
Okay, best wishes, Ritam. We'll talk later on. Right now, I'm right now ending the program. Have a remaining day and remaining evening. Have a wonderful remaining evening. So with this, we close the program. Okay, Ritam, I'm closing the program.
Okay.